Hey, everybody. So glad that you are here. Zeta, when you asked me to do this months ago, I was like, oh yeah, that sounds good. I'm sure things will be like, you know, a little more controlled with the pandemic. You know, we might be really seeing the light at the end of the tunnel. And here we are. This topic seems more applicable and more timely than I could have even imagined way back in early fall when we were first talking about it. So thanks for being here. It was actually pretty therapeutic for me to put together this presentation for myself. So much about being a health coach. I'm a health coach for UK Health and Wellness. I work with faculty and staff to really help folks get a handle on their overwhelm. And so much of these pandemic resources that we've been offering through health and wellness over the last 7-8 months have been really about practicing what we preach too. And so I find it like a really powerful way to kind of take my own medicine when I do presentations like this. I am a mama, full-time worker for UK. I have a teenager, I have a 13-year-old, and I have 2 1-year-old toddler twins. So we kind of got like, wow, we got the full end of the spectrum here. Although I'm realizing that a lot of the parenting techniques I use for toddlers are also pretty accurate for teenagers too. Little different languaging, but the same overall ideas. So I'm here to say I'm in it with you. I'm assuming you are here at this presentation because you are in it too. And so I thought we would start out today, but with just a really simple exercise that I've been using a lot lately for myself and with many of my clients. It's called the circle of control. It is nothing fancy, but what I'm gonna invite you to do is to grab a piece of paper and a pen. And if you don't have any of those things accessible to you, that's fine too. You can kind of just do this mentally, because a lot of the times when I am kind of practicing this tool, I don't have a piece of paper and pencil too. So I like to use this tool when I start to feel overwhelmed. This is a really helpful tool at 3:30 in the morning when you wake up and you are maybe ruminating. It's a helpful tool when you feel overwhelmed, when you're sitting at your desk thinking like, I can't do this. It's helpful because it really creates this laser beam focus around what is in our control and what is not. And so that's what we're gonna talk about today, is like when we are like whirling and swirling with little people and big people at home during the holidays. There are a lot of expectations. There is a lot of stress. There's a lot of anxiety. And so we're gonna talk today about kind of biologically what we can do to complete the stress cycle. Cause I can throw tools at you all day long. But what I've known and what I'm really finding a lot in the research is we have to really deal with what's happening in our body when we ourselves are feeling stressed and overwhelmed, so that then we can show up in our work, in our parenting, for our families, in ways a little less frenzied. So here's what I'm going to invite you to do. I want you to think about what is freaking you out right now. When you're imagining being at home with all your people, the people that are most important to you, and you are just envisioning a holiday season that's going to look really, really differently. So I want you to use this tool as kind of like a worry dump. So what are you stressed about? So on the outside of this circle, write down all of those things you can't control. Right? Other people's expectations of you, how other people are going to respond, the disappointment of your children with not having a holiday season that looks anything like maybe anything they've ever known before, right? Those sort of things you can't control. And on the inside of the circle, I'm going to invite you to write down of those worries, what can you control? What is within your control. Maybe it's the way that you respond, the way that you set boundaries, the way that you, you know, kind of create a new tradition for yourself this year, right? So just take a few moments. I'm just going to give you probably 2-3 minutes here and just do a worry dump. When you think about this holiday season, where are you kind of feeling the frenzy? What can you control and what can't you control? So just go ahead and kind of dump it all out. I'll put on a little holiday music here while you're writing. A little Jeopardy song. Maybe. And maybe when you're done, just give me a little thumbs up on your Zoom, kind of in the little annotation area. Just let me know that you are done. All right, give me about 30 seconds more. Let's wrap it up, knowing you can come back to this at any time. And I'm curious about what you noticed. Any realizations, anything that comes to mind? When I was doing this, I kind of did it in preparation for this presentation earlier this morning, and I realized what I was feeling so worried about, kind of the theme, if I were to kind of encapsulate it, was other people's responses. The things that I have no control over, you know, how my parents are gonna feel, how my kids gonna feel, how my partner's gonna feel, you know, kind of this like all the expectations and the heaviness weighing on me was so much about other people's stuff. Just wondering, any thoughts, any realizations that you wanna share? You don't have to share specifically what the worries were necessarily, but any thoughts that you had?
I think when I came back to like, what can I control? Part of it has to do on like how I want to look at things. So if you look for the positives or you look for ways to make situations that make you feel uncomfortable different, then that can be helpful just for your overall mindset of things.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. Zeta and Lucy kind of had some similar things like this idea of other people, right? We can't control that. Other people on the outer side of the circle, that we can control boundaries for ourselves. Yeah, what we're going to do with our time, what we're going to do with our money, what we're going to do with maybe our alcohol consumption, what we're going to do with our scrolling. Oh my goodness, the doom scrolling, right? Yeah, yeah. Any other thoughts? So what I want to spend a little time talking about today is, so maybe you've got this idea of, okay, all of these things for the holidays, maybe a chunk of them do fall on the outside of your control list, and yet they are still weighing on you, right? So what do we do with that stress, that perceived stress that is kind of coursing through our bodies? Absolutely the best book I have read in 2020. Now, the caveat on this is I haven't read a lot of books this year because it's been a little nuts at the Rodquist-Kodet House. But I do read mostly nonfiction. I'm a geek when it comes to kind of like stress and neuroscience and all that jazz. It's kind of my idea of a good time. And this year I read the book Burnout. And a lot of this presentation is going to be based on the book. And I'll send Azetta, when she sends you the PowerPoint presentation later this afternoon, I'll send you the link. It's by two identical twin sisters, Emily and Amelia Nagoski. And they wrote a genius book called Burnout. It's written for everyone, but it has a specific kind of lens on women and the burnout that we experience kind of personally, professionally, societally, on the different expectations that are put on us and what we take on and what stays in our bodies. And this really unlocked a lot for me when I think about stress and overwhelm. And I wanted to share it with you because I think it's pretty applicable to how we can care for ourselves this year. So what we know is that holidays in the best of times can be really, really challenging. But you add a pandemic on top of that, you add election unrest and just overall society unrest, injustices, the world, it kind of in chaos on so many levels, families that are kind of infighting, like there's a lot happening. And so how we support ourselves matters, because we know that when we want to care for ourselves, for others, for our families, for our work, we cannot do it from an empty cup, right? So this idea of filling ourselves up so that we can care for those that we, you know, find most important in our world and the work that we do at UK and beyond. And it's beyond kind of this quote unquote typical idea of self-care, right? Like a bubble bath is great, but we need to really look at self-care kind of from a biological level. And so that is what this book, Burnout, The Secret to Unlocking the Stress Cycle, talks about. That the good news here is that stress isn't the problem, which is good news, ladies, because there's a lot of stress. And even though we have, you know, a vaccine down the pipe, that is great news. The problem is that the stress isn't going anywhere. We don't have any illusions that our families are going to ask less of us in 2021, that the University of Kentucky is going to ask less of us in 2021, right? That our friends, that our loved ones are going to ask less of us. Just with the way the world is, our responsibilities, the stress kind of builds and builds and builds. So what we know is that how we deal with stress is really the kind of the bullseye. It's the secret sweet spot that we want to pay attention to. So it's not what causes it that is the problem. It's the way that our bodies stay stuck in stress. So for instance, let's say that you are stuck in horrible traffic, not like anybody's going anywhere, but like, you know, bear with me on this example, right? So let's say you had some place that you needed to be, you're running late, there's terrible traffic, you immediately feel totally frenzied, you're just like, oh, you're tensing up, and finally you get to the place that you want to be, right? So you would think that then because the traffic is over, you got to where you needed to go, that somehow, like, that the stressor is gone so that naturally you should be feeling A-okay, right? But we know that it isn't the stressor. It's not the traffic itself or even being late that's the problem. It's rather what is happening kind of biologically of the external stressor that comes our way, of how do we allow ourselves to kind of release the stressor and move through it. So even though the stressor is over, there is still the remnants of the stress in our body. So the goal here isn't to live in a perpetual state of like peace and balance and harmony. It'd be great. I don't think the majority of us are able to like swing that exactly. So I think this illusion that somehow we're going to like be blissed out this holiday season, or that like that we just need this perfect utopia to somehow not experience stress anymore, that's not happening. So how do we care for ourselves so that when we experience the stress, we can like move through it, that we can help our body truly imagine the stress like moving through the tunnel so that we can get to the end of it and then get ready to go back in, right? So the goal here is to move through the stress experience and not stay stuck in it. So we know that like stress is this biological response, like anything that the brain receives as a threat. And like all biological responses, there is a beginning, there is a middle, and there is an end. And so today we're going to talk about how can we move through the middle and move through then all the way to the end of our stress cycle so that we can stay healthier and that we don't get stuck as often. Okay, so how in the world do we do this? The Nagoski sisters suggest there are 7 ways to move through the stress cycle. And, you know, I would say the research suggests that 1, physical activity is probably going to move you through it the fastest and is going to move you through it most wholly. That doesn't mean that the other 6 aren't a good idea, because they certainly are. But what we know is that physical activity is what tells our brain that we survived our threat. So some of you probably know that when we are experiencing that fight, flight, or freeze sensation in our brain, right? That parasympathetic nervous system, that part of our brain that is like that primal part, is really responding to our earliest ancestor days. This is the part of the brain that's key job is to keep us alive. So when we are flooded with all of the cortisol, all of the stress hormones, our body is geared to run, to escape it, to get out of the stressor. And so when we are able to move our bodies, that is kind of like the language. It's the physiology, the language that our body and our brain understands as, okay, we've survived the threat and now we can get into a safe place. So this isn't about going to a gym. After you've had a really stressful experience, a stressful day, sometimes it is about jumping jacks, you know, like 30 jumping jacks in a row. It's maybe like jumping up and down, brisk walk around the block, you know, doing something that is going to get your heart rate up. So how do you like to move? That is the question of how can you move your body through the stress cycle? You have to use your body. Since stress is physical activity is a big part of moving your body through this stress cycle. So think to yourself, like, what do you enjoy doing? And maybe it's a dancing, like a dance off in your kitchen. You know, you turn on some Christmas music, you turn on your favorite music, whatever that might be, dance it out. Like one sweaty dance off to a song can really, really move you through the stress cycle. So don't think about like you have to go to the gym per se to like you move through the stress cycle. Any sort of physical activity that's kind of going to raise that heart rate up is going to be helpful as a way to complete the stress cycle. Okay. Another way to do it is positive social interaction. So when our brains are freaked out, when we're experiencing stress in that parasympathetic nervous system, that part of our brain that wants to stay safe, is we want to give our brain this kind of evidence that we are mostly in a safe, sane place, and that the majority of people on the planet are not trying to hurt us. And so these casual social interactions, these positive interactions that we can have with perfect strangers, can also help our body move through the stress cycle. This might be wishing, you know, your barista, you know, when you go and you pick up your takeout coffee, or when you go into the Kroger, or when you, you know, have these experiences with, you know, walking around Target and you see somebody wearing, I have here like awesome rain boots, because I saw a lady with super awesome rain boots a couple weeks ago. I was like, and I just told her, those rain boots are awesome. And that was it. Like, just this genuine experience of, hey, connecting with somebody, a nod and a smile through your mask, wishing somebody genuinely a pleasant day, all helps to calm the brain and remind it that you're safe. Because that's what the brain is trying to do. It is trying to feel safe so that it can release the stress. So thinking about what are little ways that you can extend kindnesses that feel genuine and real out in the world. It doesn't have to be anything big. Small social interactions can help to buffer and move you through the stress response. Number three. Creativity. I loved this one, that making something can move you through the stress response. So I think sometimes we think like, oh, we're not creative, or like that's somebody else. I don't regularly frequent craft stores like my mom and my sister do. They are both incredibly artistic and do a lot of use with color, right? But there's more to creativity than maybe just the traditional, you know, a way of doing art, right? So how do you like to be creative? That might mean being creative in your garden. That might mean knitting or painting, singing, writing, modeling clay, even a little playtime with the Play-Doh, doing some funny karaoke, anything that is a creative endeavor that speaks to you also allows the brain to experience kind of this safety. It puts you through to this flow experience and helps to calm the brain. Okay, I had a couple chats here. Yeah, yes. So Lucy was saying like cooking, totally. That is a huge, huge creative expression. You know, even like putting, something I've been doing lately has been kind of creating these kind of like playlists for myself based on mood. Like, do I want to feel energized? Do I want to feel peaceful? You know, so kind of that too is a creative endeavor. So that can be huge. Lucy was saying not just feeding the family, but having time to try a new recipe. Right on, Lucy. Absolutely. You know, and kind of like creating a space around that. Maybe that just means lighting a candle. Maybe that means intentionally like putting on an apron and putting on some favorite music, pouring yourself something delicious to drink, like kind of giving yourself a few moments. I think sometimes it feels really overwhelming, like all that stuff is going to take a lot of time. Giving yourself permission to kind of offer yourself comfort in that way can really, really be helpful. Okay. Number four, laughter, right? Hallelujah, this is on the list. And I'm not talking about like the fake social laughter that you do when everybody's uncomfortable. I'm talking about like the belly laughter. What makes you laugh? And the research even suggests that tapping into a part of you, a memory that made you laugh, that was funny back in the day, can also kind of bring on those endorphins and kind of create that environment of laughter too, right? So allowing the laughter is a way to release. It allows those difficult emotions to move through us physically. So laughter does this, remembering a funny story does this. So neuroscientist Sophie Scott suggests that we use an ancient evolutionary system that mammals have evolved to make and maintain social bonds to regulate emotions. That's what she has found that laughter does, right? That when there's laughter, it's another way to signal to our bodies and our brains, we are safe. We are safe. Yeah. I think I saw a chat here. Sorry, everybody, grabbing my pieces here. Okay, affection, number five. So physical affection helps our body release because when we experience those trust and bonding hormones like oxytocin, so that's the hormones that's released when we nurse babies, that's the hormone that's released when we are, you know, after sex, that's the hormone that is released when we are embraced and in a close social connection. And it helps us to, once again, feel that we are moving away from a place of danger. And our hormones shift, our heart rate slows, our body begins to feel safe. And this doesn't always mean that it has to be with a romantic partner. You can feel safe with somebody that can give you a long, strong hug. And I realize in the way of like social distancing, that's really hard. Like that we aren't able to hug most people, but you kind of tuck this one away for the future. The research is suggesting about 20 seconds. That's a long hug. I don't know. I'm not a huggy person. This one doesn't appeal to me as much, but for those that really love, you know, and kind of feel that nourishment of a physical touch, keep that in mind. Your magic here is about 20 seconds so that you begin to release. Time with a loving pet, time petting, cuddling animals lowers blood pressure, also signals to the body you're safe. Same with connecting with meaning and spirituality. So reading through a sacred text, having like a journaling, a prayer practice, a meditation practice, that also has that same effect of releasing some of those trust and bonding hormones. And the 6-second kiss. Once again, that goes back up there with the 20-second hug. 6-second kiss is a long time. So try it though, right? If you have somebody in your household that, you know, a partner, whatever, that is that safe person to have a 6-second kiss with, try it. It's a little uncomfortable at first, but a really powerful way to move through the stress cycle. And what I thought was interesting, because I was like, really, like, what's up with the 6-second kiss? And what the research suggests is that your body can signal you're not going to be kissing a person for 6+ seconds that you don't like, right? So that's another way that your body kind of signals of you're feeling safe. It's a safe environment. So physical affection can be a powerful way to release it. Kids, pets, and significant others and relationships that feel safe, really powerful ways to complete the stress cycle. Okay, last two. Number 6 is a big cry. Right. So the message here is that crying is for everybody. Babies cry, little kiddos cry because it's good for them, because it's their body's release that they haven't learned yet to shut it down. But oftentimes for adults, right, we get those messages of like, oh, we shouldn't be crying. That's inappropriate. But crying is one of the most powerful ways for our body to release the stress cycle. So especially if you feel embarrassed or if you struggle kind of showing that emotion, there are some ideas to kind of help you do that, right? So watching a tearjerker movie totally counts because you are really following that character and the storyline, but your body is experiencing like its own situation. So really, even if you know, like, man, I need to cry, and you can't kind of like trigger to do it on your own, that is a powerful way. Watch a really sad movie, right? Listening to deep music that elicits that deep response. My grandfather would always listen to this one opera, and it would make him cry every time. So really, the arts, the music, movies, all of these things have a powerful way to elicit that response and move us through the stress cycle. So going through the emotions, whether it's on your own and giving yourself permission to do that, or, you know, using it through characters or music, it all counts. It's all a good thing. So a good cry is one of the most powerful ways to release the stress cycle. Okay, we got a few comments here. Hey, Nancy was saying the creative piece, cross stitching and a Christmas pattern as I listen right now. Beautiful, Nancy. Awesome. I love it. Just all that stress, it's falling off. It's like moving through the stress cycle as we speak. Awesome. Lucy was saying she has face hugs where she puts her cheeks together with her kiddos ear to ear. Yeah, still intimate, right? But not like breathing the same air probably. I love it. What feels comfortable? What works for you? And Danielle said that her three-year-old just says, it's okay to cry. And sometimes big girls cry too. Absolutely. Big girls cry is totally cry count. Yeah. Big girls cry and little girls cry and big boys cry and little boys cry. Yeah. It's so important. Crying is, yeah, one of the powerful ways to move through. Azetta was saying she loves the face hugs and the super long hugs. Awesome. And lastly, folks, is breathing, right? So this probably isn't a surprise. There's a lot of research around the power of the breath. Those deep, slow breaths to down-regulate the stress response. I found in the research a few years ago, which was a surprise to me, that the power is in the exhale. Like, obviously the inhale is important, but I would put a lot of concentration on the inhale. The exhale is where the magic happens, folks. So to be able to move through that stress response by really focusing on the out breath, allowing the breath to push down deep, deep, deep into the belly so that it contracts. Sometimes what I like to do, I've written a couple breathing options here, is the manipulation of the breath. So anytime you hold the breath and then exhale is awesome. So like the square breathing, which is inhaling for four, holding for four, exhaling for four, holding for four. Another one that I love, and let's do it together. This one is the 4-7-8 breath. So this is inhaling for four, holding for seven, exhaling for eight. So let's just do maybe three rounds of it. I'll count us through for the first two, and then you can do the last round on your own. So let's, just gonna invite you to just put your feet on the floor, push your chair back if you're maybe at your desk. Just kind of do a little stretch here. Allow your focus to come back to the breath. And I'm going to invite us to take a deep inhale for 4 seconds. and hold for 7, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and exhale for 8, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Inhale for 4. Hold for 7. Exhale for 8. Last one on your own. Yeah. So that is the 4-7-8 breath. If you haven't done a lot of breathing, especially with the hold, it can feel a little disconcerting. Our body does not like to hold its breath, right? Our brain is like, no. We want to stay alive. We want to breathe. So that is, can be a little challenging. My invitation here is to play with it or to find a breathing tool that works for you. Did anybody have a comment here? Yeah, maybe. So try the breath, anything where you can especially focus on that longer exhale. So if the 4 and the 8 feels a little too long, shorten it. Do the 2 minutes in, or 2 minutes, oh my, no. 2 seconds, hold for 2, or breathe in for 2, hold for 5 or 6, and then exhale, you know, maybe for 4, and kind of build up to it. This, the 4-7-8 breath, has a lot of research behind it with Dr. Andrew Weil. He is a physician and researcher at the University of Arizona that does a lot of both Western medicine as well as kind of Eastern modalities. The square breathing, I first learned about it through the military. They really use this with their active soldiers to help for concentration and focus. There are a lot of cool breathing apps out there too, right? I just listed a couple. The Calm Breath is powerful, or the Calm app is a powerful one. Insight Timer is one that I really like. I can use a lot. My colleague Jackie Hansen does an amazing program called Koru. It's a 4-week session on mindfulness breath that she does seasonally. And really, really great tools and techniques that you walk away from, as well as the MBSR, the Mindfulness-Based Stress Reduction, is a program through UK as well, that is a little deeper dive into mindfulness and the breath, but definitely check us out on the health and wellness webpage and learn more about those things. Lucy was saying she really likes the app Relax Melodies. Lucy, I haven't ever checked this one out. I may have to do that. Variety of sounds and meditations with other paid version. Yeah. So a lot of these apps, you know, will have a free version, as some have pay versions too. I find, at least for Insight Timer and the Calm app as well, that, you know, for just getting started, there are plenty of meditations and relaxation tools that are free and available at just the non-paid version. So there's a lot out there. And Lucy, I'm definitely going to check out Relax Melodies. That sounds interesting. Yeah. So my friends, this is just seven tools for you to use this holiday season when you feel the stress building up, moving through it as best you can. And the goal here isn't a total stress-free existence, right? Like, let's be real. Rather, it's tuning in and trusting your bodies. And this is I love this quote. This is also from the book Burnout. It says that, so this idea of granting your body permission to be imperfect and to listen to your own experience. Because I was thinking, like, how do we know? How do we know we've moved through the stress cycle, right? And I think, and what the research in the book Burnout is suggesting, is listening to your body. It's like knowing when your body is full, right? You know what that feels like. You know what it feels like when you're getting hungry. You know what it feels like when you feel tense. You know what it feels like when you feel relaxed, right? So using your body as a guide. And the Nagasaki sisters say, wellness is not a state of being, it's a state of action. It is the freedom to oscillate through the cycles of being human. Real world wellness is messy, complicated, and not always accessible. If you sometimes feel overwhelmed and exhausted, that doesn't mean you're doing it wrong. It means you're moving through the process. So give yourself grace, graciousness, and permission to tune in, to figure out what techniques are going to work for you when. You may not always be able to do the physical activity one or the breathing one or the creativity one, right? So figuring out what is possible in the moment that you're in, doing the best you can with what you've got and filling up your own cup so that you can support those that you love and the work that feels important for you to do in the world. So if you want to do a deeper dive, here's some ideas. Reach out to me or my colleague, Jackie Hansen. We help folks make a plan to complete their stress cycle more regularly. That is a big part of the work that we do. Check out the webpage here through. So if you go to the HR page and type in holidays, stressed, for well-being support for body, mind, and heart. So UK work-life connections, as well as health and wellness. We've put together as many resources as we've got to really support you through the overwhelm, through the frenzy, through the fear, through the feelings of anxiety and depression. There's a lot of juicy goodness there, so definitely check it out. Check out the book Burnout. It is good. And I know you don't have a lot of time. I really, really get it. So even like listening to it on Audible or getting it, you know, getting it through the library, putting it on CD, whatever you've got available to you, if you're looking to go do a deeper dive. And at the end of each chapter, they've got these really great headings that is too long, didn't read. And so they do a nice synopsis at the end of each chapter, which I find to be super helpful. And lastly, the invitation to stay curious and playful as you care for yourself during these holiday seasons, as you are moving through this really difficult time of year and beyond into 2021. This is hard and you are not alone. So let me stop there and kind of